what's up, what's up, what's up? Another installment of the King's Cast right here. Do us all a favor, please go there and like this episode and also subscribe to the channel for some more exciting everything that SPHEctacula and DJ Naves bring to you. I'm so excited about today because, hey, Katela, Bambase, Golio, Zafa. Ah, Zafa. Where you from, Soweto? Where you from, Pretoria?
Well, yay. This time,
I can say I'm excited because somebody from my whole province is in the place to be. Listen, this guy is so amazing. We call him the mayor of a whole province.
Well, it is.
But only he can do it, right? Who we're talking about? Mr. Makoya Berries, DJ Tira in the place to be.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Sure.
Oscar Berry.
Hola, hola.
Welcome.
Nandi.
Thank you for the presents as well.
Ah, man, of course.
Siri Berries.
Ah, it's
figure, smelling like
figure
money.
Strong, hey. Skatele.
Tell you about
it. Ah, again, eh?
Yeah, no, mad love. Like, I mean, for people that don't know, right? From Guatlabisa to the world, this is the story. That's the title of the book that Tira's gonna write in the future while sitting at his condo in Hollywood one day. I was like, hey, how's good to manja and Guatlabisa ngila? Hey! You speak to me, talk to my people. So those are all the successes like that I wish for Tira, because here at home, you've ticked off so many boxes and been so amazing and inspired so many people and made a difference to so many homes as well by the people that you've opened doors for. I want the world for you, because now it's your time to go, no, I've earned this. So that's what I want for you personally. That's really all I want.
Yeah.
So I want to ask you, because you never really talk about this like a lot, like it's hard to research. Your family structure, I'm aware of, obviously your mom and your dad, and I know your brother as well. And I just don't know whether there's any other siblings. Also, like, what did your parents do for a living that might have instilled, you know,
So mean I'm from Guatlabisa. I studied on my primary school, Guatlabisa. I went to Anongoma to do high school. I went to Mlogo, I went to Begzulu. It's just me and my brother, Nipo, younger than me.
Okay.
So it's just me. My mother is a nurse. Retired now.
Yeah.
My dad also is a teacher. It's Kaun College, but retired now.
I retired too. My son is bringing all these millions.
So just by four. But obviously, we've got so many close cousins, relatives, sisters, that we call sisters, call family under the surname Yagakati.
Nice.
What's your fondest memory growing up?
Yeah.
Just as intwana ukhula, what's the one thing, a highlight, ehlala ivela nje uma ucabanga ekhaya?
Hey, I want a highlight bethu. I think it's date back to my bedroom listening to Vusiletswalo mixes.
Yeah.
On Metro
That's so
FM.
Crazy. That's the same story I share.
Yeah. On Metro FM.
On that 6 o'clock show on Saturdays.
Between 7, 8,
yeah,
you know,
exactly.
I'm like fascinated by the way they're doing those mixes, and I'm like, you know.
One
so
day.
I wouldn't miss, you know, a Saturday. And of course, we did nothing but just to chill or just play soccer.
Yeah.
But there wasn't any much entertainment, so it was just like that. Otherwise, other entertainment, it was at high school. Slingiselo Jodesi, you know, wearing those
babies. Which one did you do? Which one did you do? I want to know. Which one did you do?
Okay, we did like a Jodesi stay.
And from the group, which guy did you play?
Oh man,
I was the lead. Okay.
Yeah, man.
Right.
So yeah.
Crazy. And now with all of those things, I mean, growing up and entering talent competitions as they were called then, right? And you were a lead then to later on in life leading.
Because I mean, high school Umuntu was involved in entertainment committee, you know, organizing
Vasi
movies, organizing, you know. And then after that, I saw Spear Student Village. I'm like, this guy was doing what I was doing, but on a more kaka level. You know, so I think it was just like that, man. I mean, a person has been involved in entertainment for the longest time. And then up until high school, then that's when there was a name Yatira was created.
Yeah.
You know, when I get to Howard College, I was Tero. Tero. Saying Tero. And so this other guy called Sandlim Tia, and I was like, Tero. That does sound
don't
nice.
Have that thing.
You know, when you are tiramicious.
Yeah, it was the Mishas like, era.
I mean, like, I like the tiramicious. Yeah. I can see the Mishas, but the Tira, I can ride with that.
Yeah.
Then it was the Tira that we know now.
So basically, Tira, the name DJ Tira, doesn't really have, or does it have a meaning, or is it just like...
No, from it's the just India a remix of a remix of a remix of a remix. In high school, I was Kachi, but I am Kaitero. Then it was Tero. Then it was Tero. Then I, and then Varsity was like, Tero, not swaggerish.
No. You know?
Let's try Tira.
Misha. And leave it at that.
Yeah, yeah.
You're crazy. And to think that now everybody just like knows you as Tira. Maybe a kaya, but everybody else.
I can't even mention
your
mama now. You know, with the Tira,
Let me ask you a question. I mean, I've shared the story countless times of my eureka moment with wanting to be like what I am today. And that was seeing Upop Mabena play Shaba Ranks' Mr. Loverman, a stadium, Gugu Festival. That for me was like, oh my goodness, I want to do that. What was that moment for you?
I think for me, in 96, that's when I learned how to DJ. I think I was seeing Abo Pumshaka and Abo Oskido coming to Durban to perform in Natal Tech.
I remember those days,
Or was that place called Green Village or something?
Yes. Ecovoli,
you know, those vibes. I was like, yo, now these guys are vibing. Yeah. You know, they're vibing. So now me, instead of, I started to save, like, money, like pocket money. Instead of buying a sneaker or whatever, I would buy a record. Yeah. And at that time, a record was 100 rand.
I was like, it was heavy. And it got made one.
You know what I'm saying? I think my first two records that I bought was Uchante Savage, I Will Survive.
Wow, that's crazy.
And I forgot the other one, but yeah, Uchante Savage was the first record that I bought.
For that remix to come and it's so long as the beat goes on.
So those are the vinyls that I learned how to DJ with. Yeah.
I actually think Tira was listening to the same mix I was. Because I shared about that Busin Tswalo mix. So this DJ was cutting from Shante Savage and this What's happening? I'm listening
and then you hear California Love coming.
What a moment.
That's crazy.
What a moment.
It's crazy to to think that the base of this was then urban music, or Bizani International at the time. And that's what like literally propelled you to start DJing.
No, definitely it was. I mean, the vinyls locally, you know, they came in very, very late. But where it started off, you know, it was like those international mid-tempo, you know, songs that, you know, kept us going.
All right. Setting a premiere.
Yeah, boba. Hey, Rajesh. Hey, yo, Rajesh just called me like, yo, by the way, I still got those vinyls.
Stock is in, come get. Okay, so then I know that in the same vein, you'll remember how big DJ Sox's annual Christmas parties were, like back in the day, the real beginning of the underground at his house. What, at that stage, were you already close to him? Because you spoke about having started DJing around that time as well. Had you guys already started to form a union? Were you playing his gigs? What was happening with you then?
I think, you know, my collaboration with Sox really kicked off, I think, after like 2000.
Okay.
You know, like 2000. That's when, because before 2000, I was more building in the township, DJ Komoza, you know, having a sound system, going to play Kwasanti, going to play, you know, in those townships. I was focused on that. And then there was White House, which introduced us to clubbing. Yeah. And then after it was Tilt. Then when time for Tilt, it was time for Devon's Finest, it was time for DJ Sox house parties, it was time for a little bit of collaboration with Kalawa and Fresh and Glenn Lewis.
We're going to come to all of those, don't you worry. we're going to get to all those stories because there's so many business lessons like in all of those, like which I want to actually draw from today. So, and the first one I'd like to go to is, there was always this talk when I was coming up as well, of Oskido's involvement in actually helping you form Afrotainment. Mm. Please take us through that story.
So I started vibing with Kalawa. you know, as a family. When they were coming to Durban,
yeah.
I remember I was staying in Malvern, and the guy said they're coming. So I was like, yo, hey, I was kido, nabo mahuta. You know, they coming, nabo speaker.
Yeah.
In fact, even before that, my relationship with them started when, you know, they were organizing music videos. You remember the music video of Spikiri? I think there's one of the first music videos of Spikiri that was shot in Durban, and I had to run around and organize a house in Zimbali and blah, 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 blah.
Then.
But then, you know, I was just that guy who could organize, you know, chillas, plomas, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And at those times, they were not talking. I had the plug. You know, and we will blummer with the guys, and you know, we'll have a good time. And I think the relationship with Oskido grew from there.
Right.
Because later on, I think around about 2004, 2005. That's when we took things serious in terms of now musically.
Yeah.
Then, you know, we produced the first record, which was a Durban.
Yeah. Was that the first record out of?
Yeah.
Afrotainment.
Not Afrotainment.
Out of studio. So when you guys decided, look, we're gonna go into studio and make music. The first record you guys made was a Durban.
Yeah. So yes. So Oskido had obviously a Tizozo emceeing a gig, you know, at this other party. In fact, it was at Greyville Racecourse.
Right. Okay.
I think it was the 31st of December. Yeah. You know, like Tizozo, hey, mafuno jiva, was it happening? You know,
doing his thing, yeah.
There's something here.
Yeah.
There's something here. But I think at the same time, already, Kalawa was already vibing with Professor.
Okay.
You know, so the guy said, you know what, in fact, you guys, we're going to
put you guys together
and let's see what's up. And then Oskido said, boy, let's fly to Johannesburg, going to Kalawa Jasmine Studios. We're going to record this record called Was a Durban, and we're going to form a group called
Tizozo
and Professor.
Yeah. Right.
Then we go to Joburg, and then we're expecting to go to studio, and then Oskido said, no, we've got a gig, so Calabash. Went to Calabash. Calabash. You know, and then like 4 or 5 o'clock, and then Oskido said, okay, now we're going to studio to record.
Wait.
I'm like, huh?
Jan Manj.
And that's when we went and went to Kalawa's Jasmine Studios and we recorded. And like, okay, me, I was chilling. Me, I'm not a vocalist, guys.
Yeah.
I'm not a vocalist. So me, I'm chilling there. You know, I'm like, Kona no Pandora, you know, vibing, you know, everything is nice. I'm a professor, they doing that thing. And then Oskido said, I'm a man, jump in the booth.
Yeah, say something.
Like, jump in the booth. Guess what I said? Tira, Tira,
Tira. Left it, done. Time. And the rest is history.
It's insane that for your first studio session, that's what comes out of it.
Yeah,
Do you know what the difference is, Naves?
Yeah.
He didn't have a Naves. Because like, whenever kept, I say space, he mutes all my vocals.
crazy. Then from there,
I saw that, okay, fine. So there's this thing called the record company. And Kalawa Jasmine is doing it nicely.
Yeah.
Then I was like, okay, fine. You know, in fact, let me form my record company.
Yeah.
Which is Afrotainment. Mm. At that time, I had a sound system company, which was Afro Sounds.
Oh, okay.
I remember. I was like, okay, fine. Afro Sounds, why don't I do something like Afrotainment?
Mm. Right.
And that's when I registered the company Afrotainment. And then, after that, I bought a house because I had to buy a studio.
The infamous.
Studios. And then...
I called
Oskido to help me get the equipment of the studio. So Oskido said, no, come through, boy. I know a person who can plug you. And then he said, you need to buy this. So I bought all that. Then took it down to Durban. Then ran. And then I had a partnership with Kalawa in terms of releasing my first projects, which was Afro Soul, the Afro Pop group, and
them.
Big Nas.
Yeah. Yes.
So there was that joint venture between Kalawa, Afrotainment, and Universal.
Mm.
So I did those two albums with them. And then after that, I was like, in fact, it's okay, but come on. I can do this thing myself.
Yeah.
Then I went and looked for a person who could distribute music for me.
Yeah.
And then I was like, okay, fine. I'll get someone to distribute it, then I'll market it myself.
Yeah.
Then I've been working hard since then.
Phew. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Who would you say opened the door for you, like, though, as DJ Tira? I mean, like at the time, like when you were kind of seeing the future, people that were big in Durban were your DJ, Sianda, obviously. There was Andrea, remember? He was doing the hip-hop there with the vinyls. There were all of those guys, plus the squad, let's see, Sassy Vibe 2000.
Yeah.
So who kind of opened the door for you to jump on?
So basically, it was Vibe 2000, firstly, obviously, with those parties. And and I had a record, ne?
Yeah.
I had a record that no one had. Special Night.
Right.
So the guys needed Tira in order for Special Night to play.
Yay! That's crazy.
Yeah, so that's how I sneaked myself into Vibe 2000. Then I was part of Vibe 2000. Then at Vibe 2000, I met DJ Sianda.
Yeah.
In fact, DJ Sianda, I met him before because he's the one who introduced me to Jimmy. Dr. Jimmy Mtembu,
right,
who teach me how to DJ.
Okay.
Vinyl mixing. Right. He was introduced to me by DJ Sianda, all from Mlazi.
All right.
Yeah, well, so after that, yeah, it was Vibe 2000. Then after Vibe 2000, it was the parties. Or after the competition, that's Men of DJ competition, it was...
I'll never forget that.
Yeah,
the next morning on YFM at the time, all we heard about was, there was, which one? I think it was the one that happened at Electric Workshop.
Yeah, Electric Workshop.
Bakala Ngodira. And that time, we were too young to go. I was too young to go there.
Yeah,
so, Slalile Msakazweni, Bastella, the wave is you are
a
core. It's you're too young, but you wanted to be a part of it so that you could hear Uguti. No, Tira, no, Wenzeni.
And then on top of that,
we're from Joburg, so this is this one. Uguti, Sasekoli, Agnamunto, Stella next. But Zonke, Liz, Sasekoli, Tarapoil, and Tuana, Seteven.
For me, it was even crazier because I was fortunate to be there that night. I was there that night, and obviously, I've known Tira for a long time, like being from Durban. So I'm there with all this hope in my heart that you gotta win this, you know? I want Iggy Small jump on, do your thing. Mondays come on, do your thing. DJ. Mpulo comes on, does his thing.
Mpulo!
Mpulo, name was hot, man.
Yeah.
Positive K jumps on, does his thing. I think Silly Bean as well.
Yeah.
Then Tira comes on. Ay, 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 ay. No, no. Was obvious. Obvious.
Yeah, no, I hit them with the three record.
Yes. So that was the madness for us because Tira.
And it was 10 minutes.
Yes. Umonde was the, you know, for us. Said, "Oh, how Umonde? Jani."
And I didn't even expect to win, eh?
Yeah.
I mean, I played, I was like, okay, fine. The set went well. I was playing to play, I don't know what I was playing, but 10 records or whatever in 10 minutes. I have these three records, so everything was on point. Okay, fine. Then I went to chill there, the VIP upstairs, you know?
Yeah.
Lonely, a boy from Durban. Ah, Mnandi, I keep like 10,000 people down there. Hey, good no Let's fresh, no mosquito, no
everyone.
Yeah, and then the guy comes and gets me, ne? He's like, Excel, you need it down there. I'm like, yo, this guy, that means they want us to repeat.
Yeah.
I'm sure they're not sure, they want us to repeat.
Yeah.
And this guy says, no, you've won. I'm like,
what do you mean I've won? What kind of doors do you feel like that opened for you though? That particular win?
No, that one really, really, really introduced me to South Africa.
Yeah.
It really introduced me to South Africa. And then after that, it gave me an opportunity to work with Kabzela, you know, through Glenn Lewis. Glenn Lewis saw opportunity, was like, this boy, we can do something with him. He's doing well in Durban. He's a good DJ, so let's do something. He's the first guy who took me to Swaziland. And we had that compilation, The Real Makoya.
Yes.
So that kicked off my career, and then after that, it was DJ Fresh who also like helped us to put together the Durban's Finest.
Yes.
Yeah. And then of course Oskido. So I think those three guys really played a huge role in that.
Shout out to Glenn Lewis, man. Glenn Lewis has opened so many doors. And he's got stories for days.
Yeah.
So like Glenn.
So then the question on our minds is that one. So where does the Makwaya Bearings moniker come from? Ngopela, now mind you, the Makwaya compilation. Is there a connection there?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the Makwaya name came from the compilation.
Okay.
Somehow, there was that real Makwaya name that came out there. Mm. Then when it came out there, I was like, okay, I'm running with this one. put my first nice car, which was an OD, A3 yellow one.
Yeah, and I remember like, that one.
I was like,
Was that before or after the Mini? Was it before or after the Mini?
It was before the Mini.
Okay.
Yeah, this one, Makwaya ZN. Yeah. I'm riding with this one. And then came the greatest of them all.
Yeah.
I said, no, you are Makwaya Bearings. Yeah. That's Mampija.
Okay.
Who came in with the Bearings name. That's why there is Makwaya Bearings. Mampija came in and said Makwaya Bearings.
Okay.
Tick.
Yo. Crazy, right?
Yeah.
So many stories to remember and go past. I mean, when we moved to Durban, I remember jumping on a phone call with you. So I guess all the stories, I mean, like if you think about, I mean, my mixing residency on Drive started because of Glenn and Unati.
Yeah.
And to think of Uguti, Glenn also opened those doors for you. And then the pass on and the knock-on effect of the doors you've opened for all those other people.
Other people.
Who you come up with, or rather, who puts you on, shows you kind of how to do it so you can pass it on to the next generation.
Yeah, for sure.
With that in mind, like I think for me now, I kind of understand better where Lestayela comes from, of going to the club and rocking first and then going to the studio, because that was a standard. You go to Saturdays, give to the club at Afro Lounge, get rock on 7, go to the studio, go shower. Now, of course, your neighbors hated that.
Yo, bro.
Explain to me how you thought that thing would work.
Explain it, Naves. I want you to paint the picture for us.
It's 5 in the morning.
Right.
Everybody's like at the club. Yeah. And like when I say at the club, I'm talking like Beziwa. So
rocking.
Everyone is sweaty. Like, yeah. But Giwa Gatir. And I'm like, how are we all going
like
there?
All of us, the entire
all
club.
Of us. Right. So you drive up to the street. It wasn't far from Greyville Racecourse where Durban July is held.
The robots.
When you robots, yeah. 15 robots.
Yeah.
Mau corner. You would swear the party is actually like in the street, because at that stage you don't know. Because the first time you're going there. Then, you park Ziawala, Pagum Nanding, apparently the sun is coming up, and these people are not going anywhere.
Yeah.
You know? And then we are in Kenya, Pagati, in a studio session, Unavantu, by the pool.
At the same time.
Yeah. So for me, I mean, how did you think it was going to work? Because you lived
so
there.
I remember this one time, like, your neighbor was big. Please, my Tira, we've had this discussion. Please, my brother, like, the kids are trying to sleep. And I'm like, what's the game?
Yo, man, it's just that, you know, obviously, the results of that, you will always see them after the week is over.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Thursday, Friday, when you go back and see what was done over the weekend or what was done Sunday or whatever, you know, it's like, wow, beautiful music.
Let's go.
So actually, you know, me, I'm a hard worker, and as long as whatever that we're doing, it's got money in it, you know, it's profitable, it's production, then let's go. If not pay my way, you know, who's over the South African China, you know, because I mean, even when I started working with Big Nas, the guys came down from Joburg on those mid-tempo, quiet or hip-hop,
almost then, TKZ, early TKZ vibes.
Yes. And when they go to Durban, oh my God. So my brother, also school is like the lucky chimanaje. Boys, when I was good to talented gigs, really on the record that you are really, really talented.
Yeah.
So I want those flows. You were doing them on 110 beats per minute. Now I want you to do them at 125 beats per minute.
Yeah.
It's still the same thing. You know, let
just
me listen
faster
to your flow. Okay, no, change the flow. Open the beat, a gap a bit so that, you know,
you
the music
breathe,
is a bit
yeah,
relaxed.
Yeah.
You allow the music to fill in.
Yeah.
Then we've got something.
That's why we call him Togo Diddy. Now you know. Executive producer.
And, yeah. We had the music and then we had the vibe. It was El Vovo coming in to record. It was more artists coming in to record. You know, so because time is not available, but if it's available at 7 o'clock in the morning,
let's rock.
Can you catch it? Let's rock and create records.
And that's so, nice. But yeah. Then you moved, well, you moved to, you need the sales.
The sales, yeah.
Yeah, you moved to the sales.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But the house still stayed because...
Yeah.
Was that you trying to separate the two so that you
could have... Normality
and work.
No, I was chased out.
You were chased out?
Of the house.
What do you mean? Who are you chased out of the house? What do you mean?
Let me tell you.
It's yours.
Yeah, but it was his first marriage.
So we're chilling like a gig. Like around 11, 12,
yeah.
You know, during the day.
Yeah.
And this thing has been going on since the morning, obviously. You know, it's a Monday.
Yeah.
You know, and she came in and then took the keys, you know, and I continued to record. And then she brought back the keys later and I continued to record.
Mm.
Then after I finished recording,
yeah, sure.
The house of the kids are no longer available.
What?
So much. We should go to, I can't go back to the house anymore. So I had to make my charity.
So in my mind, right, the first time I'd been to the house on robots. Then the next time I see I got Tira. So I'm like, oh, lape robots, what the heck? In the sales.
In the sales.
Then we get to this apartment in the sales. I'm like, yo. How is this guy? Like, how is this guy living like this? Like,
yeah.
How does this make sense? Because later on, then I would be with U Stone from Bongo Muffin,
yeah.
And we're recording with him in studio. And he said, "You know what, boys? One of these days, you're going to realize, either you have to move out of this house, or the studio needs to move out.
Yeah,
because it wasn't going to work with both of them. They can't coexist.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's why I was like, Auntie, must all move elale, besegu samu shy balance or in, but no.
It happens, bro. It happens, bro. Now bonilo oskido. There was the house. There was movements. There's always movements.
Yeah.
So it happens, yeah.
I want to ask you now, just talking about the music in particular. One of the first Gom songs, like, which to me stood out like crazy, from, I think, the first compilation, that DJ Clear song. What is it called again?
Yeah,
something
I can't
dance. Durban's Dance.
Durban's Dance, yeah.
Durban's Dance.
Yeah.
That became, like, one of the very first This Is a Gom Song songs.
Yeah.
How come there was no further collaboration with DJ Clear at the time if Leo sounded very icy?
By the way, the first record that I produced by myself, I think it was around 2002, 2003. It was, you know, that...
I still have that record. Yeah.
You know, that was like 2002, because I like this music thing. And the production, I saw that it was important.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know, I can't play the keys. I can't, you know, do a lot of things. But you know what? I've got a vision. So, you know what? Let me see who I can work with to put on something. So that was the first records that I put out. But when we were working on Devon's Finest, there were songs that we wanted to do, to include on the compilation. But...
Yeah.
But we couldn't because of license issues.
Yeah.
So, hey, this song, we want it, but Laban Bapashaya, they don't want to give it to us.
Yeah.
So what are we going to do? Then Fresh, like, said, hey, I know DJ Cleo can pull this thing off.
Yeah.
You know, he can replay some things and bring back this song to life. And then we have a song. You know, so that's how, we were not directly... connected to Cleo. Yo, Cleo at that time was producing for album Zegasege, nobody. So
he was flying.
You know, so at least they had a relationship already with DJ Fresh. So DJ Fresh could manage to get that record for us. Yeah.
Okay.
What would you say was the first Gom song that you can remember?
I would say commercially, the DJ Sundo.
Which one?
Lucy Men. Yamnandid.
Commercially.
Yeah, okay. I think for me, I might be forgetting something, but and more on what I released on my side.
Right.
It was like, you know, because it was a hook and drums.
And amazing and drums.
It was dirty, and we cleaned it.
Yes, we did.
So, so you know, otherwise, yeah. Maybe others obviously were there. You know, there was about Tukzin, before yeah. He was Tukzin, he was yeah. called Two Boy.
Okay.
There was about Gold Max, you know,
that we were also secret producing. Song you did, yeah, Two Boy.
You yeah. Know? Yeah, it was dope.
I mean, Iwololo came out from an instrumental by Distraction Boys.
Yeah.
So there were songs that were there, but they had to be commercialized in order, you know, to make money because they were too strict.
Did you ever think the Durban dance scene would change to be where and what it is now? Because, for example, people will say Gorm is dead and whatever, and I'll be like, that's not true.
Go to KZN,
go to the Western Cape, go, you know, Eastern Cape, it's still alive. It's just Uguti. A lot of what people are consuming now is what social media does. And maybe as well, if you're from Joburg, the sound in Joburg is piano or yeah. hip-hop at the time. It changes all the time. Mm. Did you ever think that music like Amapiano would have the impact that it has in KZN?
No. Hi, about at the time, you know, we were rocking yeah. with the Gom sound, especially with the Deb and Kwaito. Before yes. even Gom came in with yeah. the Deb and Kwaito, I never thought there could be a sound that can come in and overtake us.
Yes.
You know, so, but as much as there was Kwaito, then there was Deb and Kwaito, and then there was Gom, you need to understand that in life, generally, you know, things changes
evolve.
And people taste changes
yeah, right.
and people love different things.
Yeah.
And you must show love because, I mean, when we came in, people left Deb and left Kwaito and supported us fully.
Right.
So when Piano comes in, why are we going to hate on Piano? Because yeah. people gave us love when we
Open
came
the door.
In.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
They gave us love when we came in. So now we must embrace Piano and understand it and give it its space, but also continue to do
our thing. Yeah.
You know, it's all about how you present your music. It's
yes.
not about, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
What you know, just in matter of fact, if you can present your thing well, people will love it as long as it's dope.
I have a friend, David Ratchet.
Yeah.
I took David to Teguini, and he's like, he was into Piano hardcore, and he'd be like, So I think they're still rich, and they shut down the music at 2:30. You know that 15 minutes of silence?
Yeah.
He's like, and I'm like, yeah, but this is what I keep saying to you guys.
We've been saying this to you.
If you say, your palate will be... That's all you're getting. But after that, he was like, yes, I've never in my life. Because... Literally from about 2:30 till 8 he was
it gets hectic. And you know, so you know if there is a party which has Dali Wunga
yeah.
and Tukzin,
yeah.
you know it's gonna be hectic at the club.
It's gonna
yeah.
be
it's got Kabza, it's got Tira.
Yeah.
You know it's gonna be crazy. Because
best
you know, the piano will come in and hit hard and the club will be jumping.
Mm.
And we'll have to pull up our A game as well with our sound and people appreciate it. You know?
And that's what somebody actually had said to me a long time ago, that the best thing about coming or being from South Africa is you could go to the club. And in one night, you'll hear 3 to 4 different genres of music, which doesn't happen normally around the world. Usually, they'll have a hip-hop floor, a dance floor, a whatever. Whereas Tina, all on the same dance floor, you'll have hip-hop, gom, piano.
And DJs that can mix. Around the world.
It's something else.
Amazing.
Let's look at the roster, like, as Afrotainment over the years. I mean, it's so crazy. Like, when you just look at it, like, in all the hits. What do you say to people that don't understand why some of the guys that used to work back in the day are no longer working now at Afrotainment? Like, let's say you're Fisherman's, and I think also, like, Sindor, before she came back now, like, with Hezegia. What do you say to them? Like, how do you make them explain that? Especially because then the story starts with how, like, Makoya uvalela abantu ngaphandle. And I'm like, no, it's not how it works.
It's a personal choice, eh?
Mm.
It's definitely a person's choice.
Yeah.
It's your choice whether you want to work, release music, or you good releasing music or whatever.
Right.
You know, a fisherman is chilling, doing this thing, taking his gigs. I think when he's ready to come back and make music, he will come back and make music.
The door's open.
You know? Sindo just gave us a taste. Yeah. You know? I think this thing just comes with your energy. You know? Unfortunately, Mina, only long appeal.
How do you deal with artists, Magoya? You know, the one thing I've never wanted to do, Mina, is sign artists. And I say this like, for example, Prince KP, we had a chance to sign him and we were like to him, Invit. So explain to me, and when you've dealt with so many artists,
for decades.
Hey, sacrifices, eh? Sacrifices, sacrifices, sacrifices. You have to sacrifice a lot. Because at the time when you think you're hearing a record, that's going to be my record. But nah, you've got an artist that you need to promote. You know, I've gave up a couple of records.
Yeah.
I did Happy Song, gave it to Fisherman, also did Call Out, also gave it to Fisherman. Mm. A few records that I gave to Sindo, but it's about building a person.
Yes.
So even when we did, Amerido, Sindo record, we produce, I go and test the record at the club, and I'm like, you know, for example, Amerido was produced by two guys.
Okay.
There's BFS, they did the drum, then Fisherman did that. You know, that's all that got drain, 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 drain. That was Fisherman on a cube bass project.
Right.
Still remember it like it was yesterday.
And so you were like, what?
Yeah. So at that time, we were working on DJ Sindo album, so that's gotta go to Sindo. So it's all about that, man. It's about building something and then thinking about, okay, fine. Because you've got a record label and you've got this artist that you're promoting or that you're building right now, step back, Tira. Give that artist the record so that you continue to do a compilation on
it. Finish the sentence, Naves. One summer mootless, we have now.
I mean, and I'm a chance together for life.
Yeah.
It's insane, man. I mean, I must commend you for that because I also think you have the ear, right? You have the magic ear. I'll never forget Sishaya Ipampa in the studio. And Beast Besega Palega, cool, trata,
I am a remember.
We're like, and the chorus? Chorus.
At that time, I'm like, cool. And I mean, we'd had the beat for maybe a year before that, so looks hard, man. Just say, Zala, le beat. But you also have the ear, like you caught it, and you were like, at the end of the session, I remember the words, they're like, Mafe, to send Vali Lenina for this year. Nishap, Alentoyen. And
took off. I mean, it's our best performing song of all time in our career so far.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Can I
take you guys back to that moment, like that night?
Yeah.
When we all, at the end of the night, we were just like, ah, okay, no, such a good deal. And then Tipsy came with that verse.
And then
it was like 4 or 5 in the morning.
Yes,
and then I was just evaluating the project at that stage. We're ready to go home.
Yes,
so many memories at Afro, huh?
No, too much.
And now you've moved.
Again.
And now we've moved.
Luckily,
now,
your new neighbors are not bad.
I don't even know them.
No, I met them. What do you mean? I met them, Mina.
Is it?
Yeah.
I don't even know them.
Basha and John, hey, you guys are rocking.
Listen, sure. He's also his own neighbor.
He's also his own neighbor.
I'm sure they're cool. I was so fortunate to get that house. I mean, the studio is on its own.
The main house. But it also so happens, like, and I've seen it because it's a studio. Then maybe two of us, so Hamba, so Talangaleng, I say, pull in. Then my son, dear chair, come on, I think the line, I'm going to land. But it's just like, also speaks to your nature, I guess. Everybody just feels welcome and a gaplo mega, and like, you know what I mean?
Amazing stuff. Yeah. So many relationships have been built by that.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I've once chilled with Gabs, you know, for 12 hours.
Yeah.
From the club, we went to the house, you know, and there was even the wife, you know. So now things are vibing on a different note.
Yeah.
You know, vibing with the right people, the right, you know. So we chill, go to studio, get tired of studio, come and chill by the pool and just enjoy music.
It's also amazing. I think the team that you have around, like Abom Senzisto, for example, even when you're not around, Umsenzisto, you'll still be able to call him. Motivate to sting his studio. and you know, it's just speaks to.
And thank you for that. Working. Mm. It's working. I mean, even now, I mean, I've called Max, I've spoken, so they're busy in studio now. Called Max is working on his solo project, so. Like, studio must be busy, always.
Yeah.
It's circulating, my dad.
That's the only way. The only way to get out of this is to go to studio. Yeah. I just realized something so strange.
Yeah.
I've never seen Makoya just at a party, chilling.
Hey,
it's always like
you.
An industry event, or he's playing. But Jay.
I have. Yeah, but Kumba mina ke. Ati mina ngishaye.
Yeah. How is that even possible? I've just never... seeing you chilling at a party.
Hey, I'm not that person, eh?
And that's what for me is crazy, because you are the life of the party, but you're also not the person that goes out to party.
Yeah, I think all the time is taken by the family, because at the end of the day, I have to be with the family, so...
Crazy.
And when I'm in Joburg, I get... I get...
Like, how are you finding, like, that parenting role, like where you are DJ Tira? I remember once you told me a story where... you needed to remind, like, I think your youngest, to go to Iwopela. Yes, I'm DJ Tira, but I'm also Mr. No. Carty here.
Yeah.
How do you get that balance right?
But I think, no, at home things are flowing. You know? And I think Uchichi, you know, she's understanding now that, you know, daddy is a DJ, you know, daddy is a superstar. And she's also looks like she's gonna be another hectic superstar. And yeah. I've never seen a kid who just records herself, you know, performing or talking or addressing people.
Yeah.
Like, not even a live, like, record, put a phone here and just record yourself. Why are you doing that? Why are you recording yourself? That means there's something burning inside that, you know, she's good at. You know, maybe it's singing, maybe it's acting or whatever, you know, so...
Why have you not replicated the model from Durban in Joburg? So, why nganang a studio ekoni?
Yo, I can't, eh?
Explain why. You want to know why.
I can't.
There's so many kids.
Because you're seven. Yeah.
Like the way in Joburg, it's all locked down, bruh. I locked down.
Oh, yeah, because you're not a neighbor when you're not a
because even the, and the studio is available next door, next house.
Yes.
It's available. But Joburg is just not made for production. It's locked down.
It's something in the water, bro.
And I think it's better I keep it as it is.
I was telling Spear, I once booked a hotel when we were working on 10 years and counting. And I realized, with like two nights of my hotel stay, and I was in studio literally for 2 days. And I'm like, but what am I doing? Like, what are we missing? But I also realize that the energy in Durban or even at Afro, you know, when you're making music, because Mouse Studio, you just never know who's going to walk in Mouse Afro. It's just, you know, collaborations happen.
And you know, in Durban, I could get to it in a studio at 2 p.m.
Yeah.
Rock, get tired, 8 o'clock, leave the studio for someone else to do production.
Yeah.
I go, I pass out, 2 a.m., Gapapama. I'm like, oh, perfect timing. Go back to studio.
Yeah.
Work. So that flexibility for me, just it's precious. I love it.
Makes
sense. It just makes me flow.
Look, it's working.
Yeah.
It's worked all these years. Well, your comment there has led to my next question. Are there any artists that you can name now that you missed out on signing on? That sent you something and you're like, shucks! And you slipped in it. And then now you're like, damn it, I should have signed them.
Oh, by the way.
Yeah.
Hey, Lady Two was once my artist. Imagine.
When?
Yeah, you went. Lady Two was once my artist. Like hardcore.
Asimlan, if it's David, if it's in a contract.
Like, I know, like, yeah, so that's the person that I'm like, huh. Guys, I once, like, Lady Du was once my artist, and, you know, we did some records, but, you know, they never pop. And later on, she was like, boom.
Everything happens,
you know,
when you
she's hectic. Yeah. And, you know, the way she's writes and...
Her work ethic.
Yo. It's crazy. So I think that's the person that I just wonder, how did I miss that one? Because she's a strong product, yeah.
I think it's timing, right?
Yeah,
everything happens in its own
it's timing.
Time.
At that time, there was no piano.
Yeah.
I guess we didn't find the synergy on the sound that was there, even though I love the record that we did and a few records that we did, but I guess it wasn't just the time.
Yeah, our music was okay. I think there's times you go into studio and you're like, I wanna lay.
I mean, you know, a few times also I will go into my WhatsApp after I've met someone.
Yeah.
And when I go back on the conversation, I'm like, yo, this person has been hollering since like maybe like 2000 and like 2010 or you know, 2012 or something, you know, but like a few years. Like, fellow T has been on my case saying, Grodman, holla. I'm like, but it's still good. But I wish you could have done something. But these things happen.
We dealt Nofelo on Ones and Twos. He was one of the guys on Ones and Twos.
Probably on one of the seasons.
On one of the seasons we were on. He was on there. Fellow Leti,
Zane
Essay. And remember we did a duet with Zane.
Yeah, yeah,
and then Zane went and did a single on his own that went platinum.
Fellow Leti was on
Nopi Toto. Prince KP, Mshega, all of them are from there.
Yeah.
Crazy, right?
Crazy.
This industry is just crazy.
Yeah.
So, like, when somebody asks you that, with all that you've done here at home and, like, kind of seeing what the other guys have done in terms of trying to reach abroad and taking the Llanos sound abroad, I mean, like, Llanos is big now in the world. What has been your thinking around ambitions like that for GOM Music and just for the DJ Tira brand as a whole?
Yo, bruh, I mean, we've got a few remixes of Rihanna that we play on our sets now and again. And honestly, it's about finding talent that can be able to sweeten our sound, for our sound to be appreciated as much as other sounds are appreciated overseas.
Okay.
You know, a piano is mellow, you know, it's, you know, sexy, you know, it's that sound that, you know, it's easy on the ear, so it's appreciated easy, you know. We are up-tempo, we vibe as well, we've got the energy, but we just need, you know, just a few talents then can be able to, you know, break those grounds.
Because
during our time, Omunye Pesgo Munye did well, and it ran its course. Ololo also did well, ran its course. But we just needed more talent that can be able to make our sound, you know, reach those corners that we haven't really breakthrough.
Makes me think it would be so cool, like if you took like a month from your schedule and went to go live in LA or wherever is a musical house, and just had studio, had the boys here, Silana, we are making music here because it's different and fresh, and just see what other collabs like, could come in.
Yeah,
I think it's something worth looking at.
You know, honestly, if
and see Zanati.
Yeah, you know, I think it would be a super plan to really maybe take Tukzin, you know, take Gold Max, you know, and maybe take one or two vocalists, you know, just go and be stationed in US or California or whatever.
I listen to the sounds like David Guetta's making. Like,
exactly.
We could fit into it.
You know,
it's just small elements that need to be added or taken away. But because we don't have the view of it like that, you know what I mean?
Honestly, you know, the one thing that keeps me going and that makes me always believe in my sound that I'm doing, and I'm like, if you look at all these guys that do like large numbers, it's and I'm like, so my GOM is not that hectic then.
No.
I just need to polish it and, you know, shape it in a way that, you know, it could be appreciated. And I think that plan of trying to go and be stationed there will be the best.
Yeah.
It and I'm going to Ultra with you this year. Please check your calendars.
Yeah, we have to.
As a supportive father, I mean, like, you were sharing about Chichi now, but also your other son is releasing music, is in his own zone. How do you Because I often say to Naves, I think I would struggle if my son said, Dad, I want to be an entertainer. I'm like, oh, of course, yeah, I'm looking at my struggles. But you seem to have embraced that. Like, okay, well, that's what you want to do, go for it.
You know, everybody needs an opportunity and everybody needs to be guided to be the best they can be.
Right.
Chase is a racer. Mm. So, you know, hopefully in the future, that's what he's going to do best, being a racer.
Come on, Lewis Hamilton, right?
And Junior, is a tank, is into hip-hop.
Yeah.
He just needs to find his magic.
Yeah.
And he just needs focus and just working to a certain direction. Because, it's not easy to break there. Yeah. So you really need to be unique and find the sound. And be original as much as possible in order for people to appreciate yourself.
You must just keep working.
Yeah, one way.
Speaking on Chase, I remember Besega Makoya and Ifro was like, I'm like, yo, what's going on? And he's like, I don't know who had left the key. Next thing, Sizu Motia, I'm like, he's like, taming the key.
I told you, hectic.
That's crazy.
Yeah, I know.
So many memories with Makoya.
Yeah.
It's actually so funny. I also laugh about how Makoya switches modes. Mm-hmm. Like, so Plomara saw, at the crib, the grand, something song is clapping. Show Makoya. It's a, how Makoya? We were just chilling for like 6 hours. What the fuck? What's just changed? I've always kind of wondered, like, what the thinking is there. Like, do you go, like, Leo Zonio would see, manje, I'm building my set in my head, I'm here, I'm working.
Yeah, Kuku complains about that as well, eh?
Yeah.
Like, most of the time, he's the one who will tell me that, hey, greet someone, hey, respond. Because some point in time, I just, you know, get into my own space and ngicabangelize into zami nje, and, you know, what I want to do, and just have time to myself.
I think I love that.
And also, just peace, guys, peaceful. Hey, me, I love peace. Hey, me, I'm just peaceful. Chilling, and I can chill by myself at the club if I like and just appreciate the music, so cannot be all over, and I'm always all over, so I try sometimes to take time and just, you know,
switch off. Talking about like a brotherhood, I mean, here we are, Spectacular and DJ Naves, the kings of the weekend, and I mean, like, you and Sox have had Durban's finest for the longest time. I want to just understand what was going through your mind and kind of what responsibility and accountability were you feeling when Sox started diving into the wrong things? Like, what were your attempts to try and drag him out?
It's just that obviously me and Sox started a movement together, and I was on my own journey. He was on his own journey.
Yeah.
Together, we made the city rock.
Right.
Mm. Yeah, we made the city rock. So even though, you know, there were things that were happening, but we didn't like swanana completely.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I'm still a guy that he can call at any time, but obviously, I mean, you try and reach out at some point in time. It's hard because you also have your own issues that you're facing. I'm also dealing with my divorces on the side.
Yeah.
He's also dealing with his own thing. So it wasn't like we had time to ourselves most of the time. It was just crazy. But finally, when he decided to, you know, switch back and manage to fight off that situation, I was like, God loves us because we could still come back, and you
and
know how
this.
Hard
yeah.
I come back.
Yeah.
We could still come back and have a number one record and take awards. And that also helped him to, you know, rise.
Get his confidence back.
And then, like, now, we're still on different journeys.
Yeah.
I mean, Sox is also into politics a bit. Mm. He's a chairperson of
the Music Association.
So he's still running his own thing.
Yeah.
And I'm still running my own thing. But at any time, we call each other and help each other on any situation.
Whatever.
So we're good. And I think for me, I will say that what has kept me going with the fact that I try by all means not to have any beef, not any fights, no whatever. So the same professor that I did umsindo with a few years back, he can still call me now and we can still do another record, or yeah, he can still put me for whatever.
Yeah.
You know, we're still vibing.
I know, Professor. Professor will fight with you today.
Way!
Like, he's still best brothers.
Yes. Yes.
He's still brothers tomorrow, but today I'm fighting you. I love him to bits.
But yeah, we're good. We're good.
Like, I want to like also ask, like, with what's happening in our industry now and all the anxiety that's happening with so, like, losing so many people, what are you doing about your own, like, security, like, situation? Because some of the places, like, that you played in the country, you're just like,
yo, we're hectic. Yo, yeah. Hey, scary times, eh? Yeah, scary times, you know, because it's, like, really not safe. And you don't know, anything can happen at any time. And I'm even looking at my gigs now, I'm like, hi, there's some gigs that I'm not going to do. Like, really, I'm choosing my bookings carefully, yeah, because, I mean, there are some bookings that you see that, hey, that could be dangerous. So maybe just stay off for now and let it cool down. So yeah, but it's just that if it's death, it's death, you know, death will catch you wherever you are. I mean,
it's your time.
You know what, who could think that, you know, someone could be murdered at Florida Road,
yes,
one of the busiest roads in Durban.
Yeah.
I mean, just like that, you know, it breaks my heart.
All of us.
And I just wish, you know, as South Africa, as government, and as people, we could do something to protect our society. Yeah. Because this direction where things are going right now, it's not the one. And I'm not saying this because, you know, celebrities are dying, yeah, but I think it's a concern for, you know, every human being.
Yeah.
We all need to be protected, you know. It's not about being protecting celebrities, it's protecting everyone that lives in South Africa. So I think something needs to be done, and also us as a society, we just need to calm down and love each other more.
I love that. Well said. Talking about love, how do you handle and embrace all the people that feel entitled in our home province, that feel like everything goes to Magoya and we get nothing? And then you ask them, oh, okay, what have you done? Have you ever sent a proposal for something and they say no? They're like, yeah, but did I send the proposal? So how do you deal with that? Because that must affect you mentally at some stage, especially if it's something, and you're like, huh?
Man, me, I mean, my situations have proved itself more than ever again, that, you know what? Those people who talk like that is just people who are lazy. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you are lazy and you're sitting on your bum and you're not doing nothing, then nothing is going to happen on your side. But if you get up and work, something is going to happen.
And none of them have never called been you that and guy, said, Makoya, who do I call if I want this?
And I've never been that guy to shut somebody down.
Right.
You know? So for me, my door is always open. If you're coming with something that I think can work, like right now, yo, I got my proposal.
How did this come about?
So, Ngane hit me up. Ngane, the producer of Ngane, the producer of Duncan, hit me up and said, you know, he made these guys who were doing liquor, and they interested in me doing a vodka gin.
Yeah.
Everybody's doing that. Why am I gonna do a vodka gin?
Yeah.
And I'm like, you know what? Me, I wanna do a cider.
Yeah.
Me, I wanna do a cider. So initially, it was supposed to be a Magoya cider.
Yeah.
And then that Magoya name wasn't available.
Okay.
We tried a few names. There was Stingray. Stingray. Imagine. Stingray also wasn't available. Then we ended up with Pharynx.
Crazy how, I mean, we're from the era where Solantis, that all those ciders were were big, and they played a major role in the come-up, in the concerts and so forth.
Yeah, the culture, basically.
And in the culture, yeah. And so many years later now, you have your own cider.
Yeah.
I can't wait like until it gets so big that it can start sponsoring shows. No, start sponsoring TV shows.
It's going there. It's going there. I think for me, firstly, I wanted to get the taste right.
Yes.
So it took me some time to get the taste right. And after I got the taste, I was like, I ain't playing around. I'm going for 6%. Give me 6% of nothing. I ain't here to play. I was like, 6%, here we go.
Do you have more flavors coming out? What's the plan? What's the plan since then?
We've got the can right now.
Yeah.
We're working on a bottle.
Okay.
So there's going to be a 330 bottle launching soon.
Okay.
And then after that, we're still testing the market.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, this only started in December.
Yeah. Right?
So still very early stages.
Yeah.
I've only got one paycheck.
one of men.
It's December, is hey, you know.
Because we're growing nicely.
And in terms of distribution, how are you finding we spread at
I think that becomes the most toughest thing. You see already, you know, we've got a Korean ship going with SPA.
Yes.
Yeah. So SPA is our first, like, main customer in terms of trying to spread it and have it available across South Africa.
Mm.
So that SPA deal, Top SPA, should be kicking off, like, maybe mid-March or something. But Ultra Liquors and whatever, I've got a team that is very, very working hard.
Nice.
In Botswana already, we've got trucks going there.
Yeah. Amazing.
So in Cape Town as well, I think a week or two, they're going to be having bearings. So we're growing nicely. And, you know,
nice,
it's a company with just three guys.
Yeah.
So we're not prepared to expand right now. We just want to, you know, take the road less traveled.
Stabilize
and see where it's going to take it. But it's growing. It's going there. Yeah.
Amazing, man.
Like, remember how with DJ Smooth thing, like a ghost tip?
Yeah.
That this one goes shh, shh, shh. Yeah,
after the first tip. <sip, shh, shh.
laughs> I think this is so cool because it's such an important branding lesson. I mean, merchandise is so important to our game now because it's just an extra added element in terms of an income stream. So to be able to now also get a piece of people's
actual palettes.
Yeah.
It's amazing for me. Like, and I can't wait to see how big it goes.
Yeah.
I'd like to see your face on this, Tira.
Yeah. There's still another one coming. So. Yeah, I think it was a production issue.
Birthday edition.
Yeah. You see what I'm saying? You can't overwhelm you. Let me hit you. Bit by bit.
But
the bulk.
Oh, what?
Excited for the bulk.
Well, so are we. Like, where's that?
And you know, people have got this mentality that alcohol tastes better in the bottle.
Yeah.
So imagine what that.
If it already tastes this nice now, it means in the bottle. Ah.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, I also want to ask you a question around with where we are now and the developments and the tragedies that have happened. What's the plan now with Oud Danger and the Big Nas brand, like as a label head? Where are we now going with that? Like, have you guys thought around that?
We're still trying things out, eh?
Yeah.
Honestly, we're still trying things out. But for now, he's performing alone. He's just got a sidekick that helps him on stage. So we're going to start production soon, and then maybe we'll see from there what else we can do.
Mm.
But I think for now, it's just like focusing on him being comfortable on stage and see how far he can take it. And then after that, it's music. Let's see in terms of the collaborations that we are doing, if there's something that is needed to add on, or he's gonna rock by himself as Danger.
Okay.
Or whatever, you know, we're not sure, to be honest. We're still trying things out. Sometimes things, you don't force them. We cannot just, you know, wake up and say, hey, Bah Waza, Danger Waza, Man Waza, Big Nas. No, it needs to happen
organically.
On its own, organically.
Yeah.
And,
idea.
It's better if it's like that.
Fagum sends this to.
He's already got the structure.
He's already got the ad-libs.
He's got the ad-libs and he's got the look.
You guys are so silly. So just don't. Ben, I see me. Quick advice to all these young talents, DJs, producers, people in the music industry that are struggling in their relationships now because they can't find the right one. What advice would you give? Like, what kind of person should they be looking for? What are the red flags, Futhi, if you can put them there? Because, like, you know, for what you do for a living, you've got the perfect partner. She's supportive. She gets it. You know, she plays her role. It works.
But what did it take to get there?
Those are all the questions I want him to answer.
Yeah,
hey. Besides, you can't say it took a divorce. Look, because not everyone's gonna go that route.
Because now I'm getting out.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm getting out. Yeah. But I mean, get a person in fact who's down to earth, you know. Get a person who loves what you do, and get a person who's gonna catch a rag in fact.
And most importantly, that's who got in the phone.
You know, get a person who's gonna respect your space.
Yeah, boundaries.
But at the same time, tell you more better.
Yeah.
Because that's very, very, very important. If a person, if you're fucking up, a person needs to tell you that, yo, you're wrong.
Yeah.
And when that happens, melek shube ngempela, yabo? Melek shube so that you feel the pain and you don't think of doing that again. So for me, it's like that. It's not about a person who's going to be physical and about that. And if you love a person and you can see your person is not okay, that means something is wrong. So correct it and then move on.
I remember I was once angry with my girl. I don't know what we were fighting about. Yeah. And I was like, hey, mina lento mshado makhoya ngicabanguye here. Athi yini? And I told him, he's like, you know what you? And he dropped the phone. You know, it hit me at that stage. You could lend them any color like you could. I said, I'm not going to be in King and Surah.
I think we like it at the same time. Yeah, boy, or if you have found a person that you can be able to stay with and also do some years with, you know, you must be really consider yourself as lucky. Because it's really, really hard. It's not easy to find a person that is going to ride with you, you know, whether chips are down or whatever. You know, so if you have a person that appreciates you and wants nothing but the best for you, and it doesn't mind, you know, or it doesn't really take concern if he sees you hugging somebody or being greeted somebody, or kono like lapana, kono uban lapana. And now, when you just respect your space, respect the person that you're with, then it's over, sharp.
100%.
Like that. Love that. Learn from that, ladies and gentlemen, in relationships. Like, as in the industry, so we can just know what home is sorted, so let's be able to work. This is my part. Uh-uh. And we all applauded you.
Yeah.
Look how happy you are.
Imagine if Mezo moves a bit. Why did you like that picture?
DJ Frankie.
I dated somebody like that once.
I like his tone, but so is this what you're into? Can I just thank you, my nigga, man?
The whole time. Friend Zozo. Okay, question we ask everyone. What's next?
For now, obviously, something big for 2023. Mm. I'm working on an album called Malume Way.
Mm.
And if you know Malume Way, you will know that Malume Way will feature on like different genres. Mm. I did that Afro-popish song with Kola, with Kabi Nation, you know, which was very, very good, Kibela.
Mm.
So that was Malume Way vibe. At the same time, you find me vibing with the bunch, doing some Afro beats and also getting him to do my sound. Mm. So I think it's just that an album that will start off mid-tempo with some Afro beats and pick up all the way to home.
Oh, so, nice.
And then
exploring.
After
I like
that, after that is done, with those artists that I will be able to feature or work with on the Malume Way, we should do a concert at ICC on the 19th of August.
Nice. Just in time for the birthday.
There's a date already.
I see.
All right.
Just in time for the birthday. Yeah. You know, Tira, like by the 25th of December, it's like, okay, so the two dates for Fact Urban Rocks, Fact Urban Rocks Picnic, what else can we, okay, the birthday tour, what else can we add?
All right.
That's
yeah,
how it is.
Yeah, it's that. And of course, I mean, Afrotainment, we're really in production right now, working on a few projects. Zazam Simnes already got a smash that he's holding on to. And
what's he waiting for?
Wants it and he doesn't want to give it to anyone because this year he says, "Hey, what is it this year? I'm making a mutuje. I'm featuring a mutuje. Give me that guy to get away."
That's a sad shot.
Yeah, so that's that. Q Twins are doing well.
Yeah.
So hey, we just need to produce music and let's see people how they vibe into it.
Amazing. Thank you very much for joining us.
Because we can talk forever.
Yeah, we can talk forever. Yeah, we appreciate. I think we've gone way over time. Ne?
Yeah.
Yeah, I knew we've gone over time. But siyabonga kakhulu, man. I think keep blessing the industry, keep opening doors for others, be as good to them as you've been to us.
Yeah.
And akukho
okudlula
lokho.
Tango.
For sure.
Manje iyashisa-ke le mpahla kuba
kuthi uyabanjeaehambanje
ngoba kuyiphuzekilekanda
unezakaphuma